This is Mount Jefferson. The highest peak in the Centennial Mountain Range on the Continental Divide, straddling the Idaho-Montana border. I first saw this beautiful mountain range back in 2006, driving through on a business trip. I knew then that I wanted to come back someday and do a backcountry tour in this beautiful terrain.
Sunday, May 5th, 2019, Cinco de Mayo, and I find myself back in Island Park, the Centennial Mountains. 3 years ago, I made an attempt on Mount Jefferson and came within 600 feet of the summit, didn't make it. So I'm back 3 years later to give it another attempt. Kind of a cloudy day today. It's going to be in the 40s, 50s, and there's a lot more snow than there was the first time I did it, so it'll be interesting to see what it's like up there. But anyway, here I go. I'm going to give it another shot, try to get to the summit, ski down, and make a great adventure of it. My 59th birthday is Tuesday.
Three years ago, I had my ski boots locked into my skis on my back and wore hiking shoes. I had to go over a mile over the ridge to get to snow. On this occasion, I was able to wear my ski boots for a short half-mile walk to this perfect ribbon of snow. This is the South Fork of Duck Creek, leading right into the drainage that would lead me to Mount Jefferson. On this tour, I had a much improved backcountry setup in terms of skis and bindings. The skis were shorter and lighter, and I used pin bindings, which I had never used previously. This shaved quite a bit of weight over what I had 3 years ago. Every ounce counts when you're climbing over 3,300 feet and 5 miles in varied terrain. I had been using these new Armada skis and Fritchie pin bindings for the second half of the ski season. I didn't find much compromise in terms of performance, even with the lighter weight. Although I did find at times these skis were hard to mount when you're in very steep terrain. Morning hours on the lower mountain, the snow was still very much frozen and made for easy travel. But as I got higher in the mountain into sun-affected snow, the water began to accumulate in the skins, and the weight of the skis was noticeably heavier. After a little over 2 miles and about 1,500 vertical feet of climbing, you reach a stretch of avalanche slide paths coming down from Red Rock Mountain. This late in the spring, the snow is pretty stable and consolidated, so you don't have to worry too much about active slides, but evidence of slides is everywhere from earlier in the spring. Traveling across some of these frozen slide paths can be challenging, especially in the steeper terrain. Ago, entering the upper cirque and looking through the trees, I saw these rocky peaks and assumed they were the summit, so I headed due east towards them. But now I realized that the summit was actually further to the west, and I headed in that direction, diverting from my path 3 years ago.
Some kind of way.
to this point on the summit ridge and looked across to the true summit, I could see that it was protected by a steep wall of rock and snow. I wasn't going to continue and try to navigate that without crampons, so I decided to stop on the west summit, only 60 feet lower, and ski from here. The summit of Mount Jefferson was beckoning me, but you just can't take the risk, especially when you're alone. It's not worth it. But I was left to contemplate, would I have to come back one more time to finally make the summit of Mount Jefferson?
Thank you.
Do that.